Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Beyond Piggly Wiggly, Inventing the American Self-Service Store, by Lisa C. Tolbert. Narrated by Laural Merlington. Preface. Piggly Wiggly 2.0. I finished writing this book during a global pandemic that upended retailing and consumer shopping habits. Reporters wrote about grocery stores as essential services during the time of crisis. While journalists focused on new trends in shopping and wondered about stores of the future, what has resonated for me in these reports is their uncanny similarities to the past. Self-service stores first appeared and spread rapidly during the labor shortages created by World War I and a global flu pandemic. Optimism about technological solutions for improving the distribution system and reducing the cost of living fueled experimentation with new store designs in the 1920s. During the Great Depression, independent store owners transformed self-service stores into huge supermarkets that caught the most successful chain stores of the day by surprise. The economic dislocations that have accelerated disorienting changes in stores and shopping habits during the 2020 pandemic bring into sharper focus the pressures that produced the first self-service stores during the economic crises of the early 20th century. A look back at the roots of Piggly Wiggly is especially timely now, as retailers are using digital technology to experiment with store design to fundamentally change how shopping works. At first glance, our digital world, controlled by mega corporations, seems light years away from the world of small neighborhood grocery stores that shaped consumer experience a century ago. Yet our contemporary forecasts about stores of the future echo the kinds of conversations Americans were having in the early 1900s. Then, people concerned about inefficiencies in the food distribution system wondered, are there too many stores? Now, with the expansion of online shopping, we question whether physical stores are necessary anymore. If they are, what purposes should they be designed to serve? Online retailing has also generated a return to in-store clerk service and to delivery, with expensive labor costs that chain stores worked hard to eliminate in the early 20th century. Now clerks push hand trucks through supermarket aisles, assembling the orders of online customers. They are sometimes called pickers, to distinguish their work from shoppers selecting their own merchandise from the same grocery shelves. Warehouse fulfillment centers, sometimes ominously called dark stores, designed solely for servicing online orders, promise fast delivery or short-notice pickup times in densely populated areas. Some speculate that grocery chains may move toward a type of hybrid store, in which shoppers submit most of their order online, but shop in person for fresh produce or deli meats. One retail expert has suggested that robotics may become part of the theater of the shopping experience, in which shoppers can watch machines that can fill 15,000 orders a day, working behind the glassed-in center of the store space. Self-checkout machines have long been replacing supermarket clerks in the checkout line, but in 2017, almost exactly 100 years after Clarence Saunders opened the first Piggly Wiggly store in Memphis, Tennessee, Amazon began to open a new kind of clerkless store they called Amazon Go. Other experimenters soon followed Amazon's lead. In San Francisco, the Standard Market opened, a 1,900-square-foot store with no cashiers, but with 27 cameras in the ceiling. News coverage focused on the cutting-edge 21st-century innovations in artificial intelligence that made the automated systems work and presented the stores as radically new shopping experiences. But these efforts to change how stores work actually have deeper roots. Although the current generation of clerkless stores may operate with more sophisticated robotic technologies, they are more or less just Piggly Wiggly 2.0. Here are some of the most striking similarities. Small size and controlled entry. The first Piggly Wiggly, 1,125 square feet, and Amazon Go, 1,800 square feet, stores were small, contained spaces, enclosed behind turnstile entrances with a limited assortment of prepackaged goods. Coordinated patented systems. Like the patented Piggly Wiggly system, Amazon Go automated self-service with coordinated store fixtures. Patenting the technology was part of a larger plan to franchise the system. Surveillance features. Piggly Wiggly and other first-generation self-service stores engineered sight lines and included other surveillance features for monitoring customers. In Amazon stores, banks of cameras installed in the ceiling created a surveillance net to track customers as they moved through the store. A smartphone app kept track of consumer purchases and charged accounts when customers waved their phones over the exit turnstile. Clerkless stores as oddities. Like Piggly Wiggly, the first Amazon Go stores were tourist attractions, with customers lined up around the block for an opportunity to shop on opening day. They generated curiosity, but also confusion. For customers trained from birth to circumnavigate regimented shopping aisles and line up to check out at the end of the trip, shopping in a cashier-less store is disorienting. One reporter said she felt crippling indecision in her first experience of shopping in a store with no cashiers. Another observed, "At Amazon Go, checking out feels like, there's no other way to put it, shoplifting." Such responses echo the reactions of the first generation of self-service shoppers who found self-service to be a discombobulating experience and worried they might be accused of stealing. Capital-intensive experimentation. Self-service inventors promised to reduce store operating costs, but Piggly Wiggly grocery store interiors were among the most expensive to install in the early 20th century. Today, the patented technology for modern cashier-less stores costs an average of $1 million for a store of less than 2,000 square feet. Store spaces as laboratories for studying how customers use the system. Just as Piggly Wiggly used franchised store spaces as laboratories for testing new retailing technologies, Amazon developed their tracking technology by franchising it to other retailers. Amazon studied customers using the stores to improve how their technology worked in different retail environments. Amazon's vice president of physical retail and technology explained, "We observed areas that caused friction for customers, and we diligently worked backward to figure out ways to alleviate that friction." He sounded very much like the original self-service store inventors who worked to eliminate what they called congestion points for customers in their store installations. The checkout process. Checkout has always been the biggest challenge for self-service store design. The first Piggly Wiggly patent was a failure because the design created huge bottlenecks in the checkout line. Amazon's technology is designed to eliminate the checkout line altogether. In the spring of 2022, Amazon extended its cashier-less store design to a 21,000-square-foot Whole Foods supermarket in Washington, D.C. Now customers can sign in by scanning their palm instead of a smartphone. Hundreds of cameras track their route through the store, while deep learning software analyzes their shopping activity to ensure accurate charges. Electronic sensors embedded in the displays detect when shoppers lift an item from a shelf, freezer case, or produce bin. Amazon calls it a just-walk-out store, because you can skip a cash register and exit the store with another wave of your palm over the exit turnstile. The bill is automatically added to your Amazon account. Like the first generation of self-service stores, the checkout process is integral to the overall store design. While the cutting-edge artificial intelligence technology has dominated news coverage as a driving force for change in retailing, the technological context obscures as much as it reveals. Surveillance may be pervasive and invasive in our digital world, but it was hardwired into the DNA of the original self-service stores. From the start, they were, by definition, designed to automate control of workers and shoppers. The examples of the first generation of self-service stores you encounter in this book may look quaint compared to today's high-tech cameras and digital store systems, but in the early 20th century, they represented a visionary ideal of how shopping might someday work. They initiated the retail revolution on which Amazon's 21st century clerkless stores are built. Introduction. Looking backward, dreaming a store of the future. In Edward Bellamy's utopian novel, Looking Backward, Bostonian Julian West falls asleep in 1887 and awakens in the year 2000 to find a city full of new technological wonders, including a new kind of clerkless store where shoppers serve themselves. It was more than a time traveler's tourist attraction. The self-service store had dramatically reduced the cost of living and resolved the inefficiencies of the distribution system in an industrial society. When Bellamy wrote the book at the end of the 19th century, no one had ever heard of a supermarket. The self-service store was a futuristic idea, a store for a new millennium. Time traveler Julian West is astonished by the new methods of shopping he encounters in his first trip to the clerkless store. In his Victorian world, city dwellers shopped for food daily, traveling to multiple stores, bakeries, butchers, and fishmongers, the city market, and the grocery store to collect the ingredients for a day's meals. West is amazed to discover that the millennial store shoppers could find whatever they wanted under one roof. The store was a physical spectacle to behold and an engineering feat, a vast, light-filled hall ringed by large glass windows, with an impressive dome rising 100 feet above the open store floor. The furnishings and finishes were opulent. Frescoed walls decorated the space, and shoppers gathered on comfortable sofas and chairs to converse in the cooling mist of a huge fountain at the center of the hall. West is impressed, but confused. He doesn't know how to find what he is looking for. In place of the forceful selling or product expertise of the human clerk, he has to follow signs around the space to identify the right counter to find what he needs. There are no aisles of open shelving. Customers inspect samples and read product descriptions available at a counter to make their shopping choices. Only then does a clerk appear at the counter to finalize the transaction. Bellamy's model for this store of the future was actually the most important retailing innovation of the 19th century. The lavish store interior he depicted resembled the extravagant department stores of the Victorian era. Evoking their origins in the Industrial Revolution, department stores were the first retail spaces to be described as machines for selling. They were called department stores because the selling floor was organized into separate product divisions, operated by clerks who served thousands of customers daily, but had limited discretion in pricing or arranging goods. In 1876, department store entrepreneur A.T. Stewart reportedly described the workers in his huge Astor Place store in New York as machines working in a system that determines all their actions. While Stewart viewed the machinery of the department store as a personal achievement, Emile Zola's novelistic exposé of department store life in Paris decried the ways that the new retailing system converted workers into cogs in a machine. But for all the rhetoric about department stores as machines for selling, human selling ability was nevertheless considered indispensable to store profits. Even small stores needed sizable teams of clerks to fill orders, wait on customers, and make deliveries. A study of the food buying choices of 30,000 shoppers by the Chicago Tribune in 1913 revealed that 55% of consumers were influenced by retailers, while only 36% were persuaded by advertising in making their purchases. It is clear, therefore, economist Paul Nystrom concluded as a result of the Tribune investigation, that the suggestion and salesmanship of the retailer was a powerful factor in introducing new articles to the customer. Although clerk wages were typically one of the largest overhead expenses for store owners, it was hard to imagine being able to sell enough to make a profit if you hired fewer sales clerks. Somehow the store itself had to be designed in a new way to sell products automatically. It didn't take 100 years to invent a clerkless store, after all. In 1921, a group of students in a Chicago elementary school class built one of fruit crates and construction paper for a social studies lesson about community life. It was a very different kind of store compared to the cavernous, opulent millennial store Julian West had dreamed. The class was working on a lesson about how communities were organized, and their teacher began by asking them to identify the different kinds of buildings a town should have. The children listed a fire station, a church, a bank, and a grocery store. Once their list was complete, the teacher set the young students to work, instructing them to craft their structures and organize them along a residential street and a business street. Without apparent prompting, the children made their grocery a Piggly Wiggly store. Piggly Wiggly had been open in Chicago for about 2 years by the time these kindergarten architects crafted their version. Significantly, it was the only store the children identified by proper name. The new self-service chain used advertising in unprecedented ways to build a national brand identity, promoting its unfamiliar self-service shopping experience as a distinctive selling point. The students recognized that Piggly Wiggly was not like other stores. They blocked the front door with a homemade turnstile, the gear that turned the self-service machine. It is fitting that Piggly Wiggly should emerge in a social studies lesson about community organization. The students located it right next to the fashionable department store on the business street, rather than on the residential street where their neighborhood grocery would typically be found. In a food retailing landscape dominated by hundreds of thousands of neighborhood grocery stores on residential streets, self-service stores carved out a distinctive place in communities across the United States. The children revealed more than they realized about relationships between consumption and social formation. Ultimately, self-service was more than a business decision. It was a fundamentally new social practice. Though self-service stores stood out as unusual when they first appeared, they are not well represented in retailing history. Godfrey M. Labar, editor-in-chief of Chain Store Age, wrote that self-service was a revolutionary idea in food retailing that predated the advent of the supermarket. Nevertheless, he devoted only a footnote to the topic in his 1952 History of Chain Stores, focusing exclusively on Piggly Wiggly innovations. In many ways, self-service stores are still invisible in the history of American commercial architecture, submerged in the histories of chain stores and supermarkets. Beyond Piggly Wiggly reveals the importance of Piggly Wiggly as the most influential self-service store of the early 20th century, and goes beyond the history of a single firm to explore the role of small business entrepreneurs who invented the first self-service stores. When Piggly Wiggly began selling franchises in 1918, The World's Work magazine described it as an interesting and hopeful experiment, worth watching because it offered promising potential for reducing the high cost of living. Franchisees built Piggly Wiggly into the only self-service chain with a national distribution network before 1940, and the company's prolific use of advertising made it the most famous self-service store of the day. As the best-documented self-service store, Piggly Wiggly has eclipsed the variety of experiments in self-service store design during the interwar years. Besides Piggly Wiggly, there were small chains with names like Nifty Jiffy, Jitney Jungle, and Helpy Selfie that signaled the efficiency and novelty of the serve-yourself practices customers would find inside the doors. The M System stores got their name from the shape of the shelf arrangement that formed the self-service pathway. Self-service was not just a chain store invention. Independent entrepreneurs nationwide, like Robertson's self-serving grocery in Dallas, linked their names to the modern retail systems they created inside their stores. Looking backward from our 21st century vantage point, self-service seems natural. From rolling a cart through the supermarket to buying clothes off the rack or filling your own gas tank, we simply take it for granted that self-service constitutes shopping. But inventing the first self-service stores was a feat of imagination that required grocers to develop a completely new vision for how their stores might operate and convince their customers to cooperate in doing new kinds of unpaid labor. For centuries, grocery stores were organized around counters where clerks, not customers, assembled merchandise, weighed or sliced bulk products, took payment, and wrapped items for customers to take home. The importance of counter service continued long after manufacturers started canning fruit and packaging cereal in standardized, branded containers. In their efforts to automate various retailing processes, local grocers used trial-and-error methods of store arrangement. Their spatial experiments engineered new social relationships among workers, customers, and products. These inventors generated a wide variety of approaches to different kinds of challenges for implementing self-service, and their experiments represent an integral developmental stage in the invention of self-service retailing. The dizzying variety of experiments is a testament to how hard it was to invent a self-service store that worked consistently everywhere. These diverse store arrangements, nonetheless, were all identified as self-service stores. Thus, before 1940, self-service stores represented a distinctive store type. The American self-service store was created in a local vernacular social process that fundamentally reconstituted how American consumption worked. The supermarket became the post-World War II model of American prosperity, an international emblem of the success of American capitalism. But it was not an inevitable outcome of self-service experimentation. Beyond Piggly Wiggly disentangles the origins of the self-service store from the histories of chain stores and supermarkets to recover its significance in the development of a mass consumer society. The first step is making the self-service store visible again. Learning to see the self-service store. The invention of self-service retailing required widespread changes that involved multiple industries, from product manufacturers to store equipment suppliers. Historians of technology have studied a variety of specific artifacts in the complex history of automated selling. Victorian inventors tinkered with vending machines that automatically dispense products with the coin dropped into a slot. Cash registers automated accounting controls in small businesses in the late 19th century. Consumer historians have documented the role of advertisers and brand name product manufacturers who promoted self-service as a strategy for direct appeal to customers that did not depend on the sales skills of retail merchants in neighborhood stores. Chain stores ultimately took advantage of mass-produced canned goods to systematize and standardize store displays. But a technological determinism infuses arguments that product packaging made possible the self-service store, where customers could roam aisles, read labels, and choose items on their own. Much as they might have liked, product manufacturers did not design the paths customers followed once they entered the store. Scholars have primarily looked to chain store innovations to explain the origins of self-service practices inside stores. Woolworth is widely recognized as a pioneer of self-service innovation, because by the turn of the 20th century, the variety chain used open display tables where customers could directly handle merchandise. The open counter displays, however, were arranged around clerk service aisles, where the staff monitored shoppers and collected payment in decentralized locations throughout the space. Woolworth was not a self-service store before World War II. When the company announced the first store conversion to a self-service format at its flagship store in New York in 1952, a worried company official reported, "We are trying it out to see how it works and how the public will respond." Lawrence R. Robinson and Eleanor G. May, who studied self-service in variety stores during the 1950s, noted that self-service was not, in fact, a general practice in variety chains. Woolworth's tentative experiment with self-service in 1952 made it the first store to be operated on a checkout basis by one of the major variety chains since the W.T. Grant Company had resorted to the use of that system during World War II. By January 1956, only 435 of Woolworth's 2,065 stores had been converted to a self-service format. In the early 20th century, stores increasingly included open displays to encourage customers to serve themselves, but, like Woolworth, they were not understood as self-service stores. Cash and carry grocery stores cut overhead costs by eliminating delivery and credit services, required customers to come to the store to do their own shopping, and created product displays that encouraged customers to serve themselves. Business historians tend to present cash and carry stores as tantamount to self-service, but their daily operation methods still depended on clerks to assemble customer orders. So what exactly was a self-service store? In January 1916, Illustrated World offered a view inside one of the first self-service stores ever to be photographed, a small grocery store that had opened in Pomona, California, in 1915, a full year before the first Piggly Wiggly store opened in Memphis. It was a strange-looking place. You couldn't just walk right in. A turnstile controlled the separate entrance and exit. Big handwritten signs cluttered the space to help customers locate products and identify prices without asking a clerk. Albert Gerard, inspired by the new wait-on-yourself plan of the cafeteria, called his store the Triangle Grocerteria. In his first arrangement, customers had so much trouble finding what they were looking for that the employees did not have time to stock shelves or check out customers. So he reorganized everything in alphabetical order. The S section included sardines, salmon, soups, and soap. A photograph of the unusual store accompanied an article explaining how it worked in Illustrated World, a science magazine that covered mechanical innovations for a popular audience. Though only a handful of shoppers appeared in the image, reporter Lee McCrae explained that its turnstile had registered over 5,000 in its first week. Remarkably, these 5,000 customers were served by only three store clerks. At the exit, two women worked a checkout counter, where one rapidly sorted and listed the customers' packages and the other made change at the cash register. Illustrated World covered the Triangle Grocerteria in its series on Oddities of Life. The first self-service stores worked as specialized retail systems that went far beyond displaying products on open shelving to offer unique physical and psychological advantages for automated sales. Arguing that his invention was a new apparatus for selling, Piggly Wiggly inventor Clarence Saunders became the first person to convince the U.S. Patent Office to approve a patent for a self-service store design in 1917. The Patent Office went on to issue dozens of patents for self-service store designs over the next two decades. All modernizing grocers invested in new technologies with an emphasis on sanitation, electrification, and creating visually appealing displays to attract discerning customers newly alert to the role of germs and the dangers of adulterated food products. Self-service store inventors went beyond such cosmetic upgrades to profoundly change the way stores worked by organizing store spaces into systems for automatic selling. Their resulting configurations were ultimately patentable because they spatially systematized the management of store inventory, the surveillance of workers and customers, and the point of purchase at the checkout counter. Inventors used turnstiles, conveyor belts, turntables, monorails, market baskets suspended from cables, and other methods to move customers and products as efficiently as possible through the store. Only a few self-service stores were ever patented, but every self-service store embodied the idea of the store as a machine for automatic selling. The self-service store was a machine that manufactured money. In his patent application, Saunders detailed the results of the same store space before and after it was converted to self-service as the most persuasive evidence that he had invented a new machine for selling. When the store was organized for counter service with clerks filling customer orders, it sold $35,000 worth of goods in 6 months. A respectable performance for the time, comparable to a well-managed chain store. When Saunders eliminated counter service and organized the same store space for customers to serve themselves, it produced $115,000 in sales in the equivalent six-month period. It also slashed operating expenses. The traditional counter service operation had cost $5,800, while operating costs for the self-service store conversion totaled $3,400 over 6 months. With its increased sales and reduced overhead, the self-service store conversion nearly quadrupled store profits. These results, Saunders reasoned, could never be achieved in a traditional counter-service store. It simply was not possible to serve enough customers under the same spatial and time conditions using counter-service methods. Meanwhile, on the busiest days in his self-service store, five clerks could process the sales for 2,500 customers. Given that sales over the six-month period averaged about $640 per day, the average sale per customer was less than 50 cents. Self-service store inventors were the alchemists of the machine age. Their machines turned pennies into gold. Learning to see the self-service store requires connecting different kinds of sources. Store patents include floor plans that map customer pathways using arrows to indicate the direction of traffic through the space. Sometimes the stores they describe can seem whimsical and raise questions about whether the space was strictly conceptual or whether it was actually built. Meanwhile, there are myriad photographs of actual store interiors, but they do not always show a full view of the space, and it can be easy to overlook self-service systems in plain sight. Ellie Woods's IGA store in Lexington, Kentucky, looked the same as any other storefront from the street, and with a quick glance inside, you might first think it was a small, old-fashioned mom-and-pop store. The local newspaper described Ellie Woods as an experienced food merchant and one of the originators of the grocetteria. He did not patent his store arrangement. but it demonstrates the same principles of automating shopping documented by store patents. Analyzing the store arrangement reveals how Woods organized his store fixtures to create a systematic customer pathway, like the customer pathways marked by so many arrows on patented floor plans. He fenced in the selling space and instructed customers to pick up a basket from the bin before they entered the gate, just out of sight in the right corner of the picture. He used display cabinets to restrict shoppers to a one-way path down an aisle running the length of the store. They had no choice but to follow the path all the way to the back of the space. Price tags were hung from the shelves, so customers could easily find what things cost. At the back of the store, the aisle opened up in front of the butcher counter, where customers could gather to wait for service. The cash register at the front of the store defined the last point in the pathway where customers paid before exiting the retail space. The back of the store was screened by a lattice wall, beyond which may have been storage or office space, out of view of customers. Patent rationale suggests that Woods and his clerks may have used the screen space as a vantage point for surveying customers on the retail floor. 4 years later, Woods moved his store to a new location a few blocks away, and there is no record of it after that. Woods's grocerateria represents the grassroots origins of American self-service stores in the precarious small business context of the early 20th century. As many as half of the self-service stores built before 1940 were created by independent store owners like L.E. Woods. Distinguishing specialized self-service stores from typical chain store operations is an essential step for building a more accurate understanding of the history of self-service retailing as a revolution in consumer capitalism. An emphasis on the role of chains and product manufacturers has left the impression that self-service retailing was a diffuse sales practice, primarily generated through a top-down process of corporate innovation. That perception is reinforced by the fact that the vast majority of scholarship about self-service has focused especially on mid-20th century supermarket innovations. Without a clear understanding of how store installations evolved, the self-service supermarket appears to be an inevitable outcome of chain store innovations that improved store efficiency and reduced overhead costs. The social history of inventing and implementing self-service is obscured. Paul Duguay, who studied the impact of self-service in British retailing from the 1940s through the 1960s, argues that though scholars have made dramatic claims for self-service as a retailing revolution, few studies back these claims with empirical evidence of store operations. Instead, he argues, the dominance of self-service is taken as a given because its innate economic logics are bound to make it the most efficient and effective system for maximizing the speed-up of all retail operations, and thus the turnover time of retail capital. On the consumption side, an equally teleological set of arguments explains the success of self-service in terms of consumer desire for autonomy and choice. Either way, the question of how, practically, self-service changed the conduct of retail work and consumption remains unanswered. Duguay's argument that claims about self-service are both teleological and ahistorical also applies to scholarship about the history of self-service in the United States. Piggly Wiggly routinely appears in scholarly accounts as a starting point for telling the history of the supermarket, but its small size and quirky features make it hard to connect to the large self-service stores of the mid-20th century. In his History of American Grocery Stores, James Mayo asserts that the Piggly Wiggly chain introduced a radical store plan that revolutionized how stores were managed, but goes on to argue that the coming of the supermarket was not so much a physical design revolution as it was an economic evolution, shaped by business management, urban growth, and technological innovations. Rachel Bowlby considers the significance of Piggly Wiggly in the invention of modern shopping, but presents it as an alternative path, a sort of platonic idea of the supermarket that never was to be. The revolutionary impact of the self-service store quickly dissolves into the functional inevitability of the supermarket without an empirical understanding of how stores actually worked. Scholars have not recognized the consequential distinction between the widespread use of open display techniques and the systemized arrangement of store fixtures that compelled customers to serve themselves. Piggly Wiggly was not just another chain store, and it was not simply a small version of a supermarket. Evaluating self-service as a new social practice. Beyond Piggly Wiggly connects the first generation of self-service stores to the history of the supermarket through an empirical analysis of the distinctive physical store arrangements that automated self-service. I analyze how store designs were shaped by business principles of scientific retailing, the social politics and class dynamics of the retail space, and the race and gender systems of a culture of segregation. Empirical analysis of store arrangements demonstrates how small stores that have previously been overlooked or undervalued as quaint anomalies were integral to the creation of supermarkets. Given the widespread renovation of obsolete store interiors on Main Street, it is no longer possible to analyze surviving store installations. The store patents discussed in this book all contain floor plans of store interiors, as well as rationales for self-service design and, along with period photographs of store interiors, represent the best surviving evidence for studying the origins of self-service store design as the stores appeared to customers in their local contexts. Though store patents document a small fraction of the experiments in self-service grocery stores in the period, they offer important evidence of their inventors' design logic and the variety of problems they worked to address. Physical description of store interiors alone is not sufficient to understand how they constituted a dramatically new social practice. My approach to studying these store spaces synthesizes methods of cultural history, geography, and the history of technology to evaluate self-service stores as a new spatial practice. Historians of technology have de-emphasized the role of the heroic inventor to evaluate the ways that inventions are socially produced. As historian Thomas Hughes argues, technological systems are both socially constructed and society-shaping. Scholarship in the history of technology focuses on how new technologies become integrated into the mainstream, including the importance of consumers in the sociological process of invention. Because self-service depended so fundamentally on the cooperation of customers, the spatial challenges of store design document the social politics of consumption as well as entrepreneurs' business concerns. Self-service stores profoundly depersonalize the shopping experience compared to traditional counter-service stores. Their designers reconstructed power relationships between merchant and customer and between employer and employees. The space itself operated as an agent of change, transforming how consumers understood their role in the marketplace. It is crucial to consider not only how grocers experimented with different technologies and strategies for physically organizing store spaces, but also how self-service stores were symbolically represented and socially experienced by the first generation of self-service shoppers. The cardboard Piggly Wiggly constructed by those Chicago kindergartners is as important as Clarence Saunders's patent for evaluating the self-service store as a new social practice. Automating shopping and store work processes was difficult, and the solutions were not obvious. There were a host of pragmatic and cultural changes. Store inventors invested tremendous time and resources to make self-service retailing work from a practical point of view in daily operation with diverse customers. Shoppers understood the assembly of grocery orders as work that store clerks did for wages, not something they should do for free. Customers often found serving themselves to be more disorienting than liberating. Replacing human sales clerks with store fixtures and product packaging turned out to be a capital-intensive proposition. Coordinated self-service systems were often more expensive to install than traditional counter-service fixtures. Though these machines for automatic selling promised greater profits over time, that investment did not appear to be worth it to the majority of grocers, including the most successful chains, who feared they would lose more customers than they could attract in the process of convincing them to serve themselves. Self-service stores had limited applicability in the grocery business throughout the interwar years. Beyond Piggly Wiggly offers the first national perspective on the origins of self-service as a large-scale process with multiple regional clusters of experimentation. Because there was so much regional variation in the popularity of self-service, a singular focus on a local case study of stores in a particular town or city can offer misleading evidence about the origins of self-service. National patterns of store distribution show that self-service was simultaneously produced in urban and rural areas, complicating our understanding of the origins of mass retailing. Evaluating the national scope of self-service experimentation, however, offers limited understanding of the social process of invention without a closer consideration of particular cultural contexts. An analysis of store interiors in the abstract, divorced from the different communities they served, can reinforce a homogenized interpretation of mass consumer culture as a standardized experience. But the dramatic regional variation in self-service experimentation demonstrates that this was not the case for American shoppers before 1940. Given the significance of Piggly Wiggly in the history of self-service, there has been surprisingly little consideration of the extensive experimentation with self-service in the South. Connecting the Southern Jim Crow origins of self-service to the national history of this mass retailing method shows that promoters of self-service linked their stores to a rhetoric of American democracy, but that they were also built to serve systems of inequality. This book is organized into thematic chapters with a chronological framework that explains different stages in the process of invention, from initial invention in the early 20th century and entrepreneurial experimentation during a developmental phase in the 1920s, to a final stage of invention during the Great Depression, when the success of supermarkets marked a turning point in the history of self-service stores. Analyzing the physical store arrangements that operationalized self-service shopping, mapping the national distribution patterns of self-service stores, and reconstructing particular social contexts of self-service experimentation documents the complexities of inventing self-service as a regional vernacular process in the development of a mass consumer society. Chapter 1, Machines for Automatic Selling, explains how the first generation of self-service stores proliferated in the economic dislocations of World War I, and argues that self-service stores evolved as a specialized form of retailing in the 1920s, distinct from the open display principles used in most modernizing grocery stores at the time. In the initial invention stage, vending machines and cafeterias were the most important influences in self-service store design. Chapters 2 and 3 focus on the history of Piggly Wiggly from its founding in 1916 through its expansion into a national self-service chain during the 1920s. The eventual success of Piggly Wiggly as a corporate chain has obscured the grassroots invention process Clarence Saunders used to create his version of a self-service store. Chapter 2, Inventing Piggly Wiggly, 1915 to 1923, focuses on how Saunders took a full year of experimentation, tearing out and rebuilding store interiors in a trial-and-error process with his Memphis customers before his self-service system worked well enough to franchise. His struggle to secure a patent documents how Piggly Wiggly was ultimately understood as a machine for automatic selling. Saunders was ousted from the company in a stock scandal in 1923. Chapter 3, Selling the Store, 1918 to 1933, focuses on how franchisees built Piggly Wiggly into a national self-service chain and used newspaper and magazine advertising in innovative ways to sell the store during the 1920s. Most Piggly Wiggly stores were owned by independent franchisees, with five or fewer stores, not the central Piggly Wiggly Stores, Inc. The Piggly Wiggly Operators Association launched an unusual national advertising campaign in consumer magazines from 1927 to 1933. Historians have misinterpreted company ads as representative of consumer experience. A comparison of the physical Piggly Wiggly terrain and the symbolic landscape constructed in the chain's advertising reveals the distinctiveness of the self-service chain in consumer history. Chapter 4, Navigating the Self-Service Landscape, 1920 to 1940, takes a deeper look at the entrepreneurial phase of self-service store development. During this phase, self-service stores developed through a large-scale national process driven by independent store owners and local or regional chains. Self-service stores were not simply created by chain store organizations and imported into the countryside. Local store owners built their own self-service arrangements in trial-and-error processes of experimentation. The advantages of self-service stores as machines for automatic selling especially appealed to small-town inventors searching for predictable profits. I argue that, although the corporate supermarket eventually came to define the globalization of American mass retailing, the American self-service store originated in the highly competitive and unstable conditions of small business capitalism on Main Street in the early 20th century. Shopping in a self-service store was a starkly different experience than shopping in a counter service store. To understand how self-service stores operated as a specialized form of retailing, Chapter 5, The Purchase-Inducing Force of the Store, goes inside the store to evaluate the physical features and operational logic of self-service store arrangement. Store patents document varied experiments with the diverse technologies and approaches to store arrangement, but they also demonstrate shared underlying principles as inventors work to systematize the shopping pathway, mobilize merchandise, compartmentalize the self-service retail space as a specialized system, and automate salesmanship through sensory retailing. Chapter 6, Mechanizing Paternalism, The Southern Origins of Self-Service, examines the invention of the self-service store as a social process with meanings that were contingent on particular cultural contexts. The appeal of low prices is not sufficient to explain the popularity of self-service experimentation in the poorest region of the country. Chapter 6 analyzes the social experience of diverse Southern customers to consider how the radically equalizing practice of self-service shopping was invented in a culture of segregation. Self-service stores automated the authority of the merchant and offered protections to African-American customers and Southern white women that traditional forms of retailing did not. I argue that self-service stores embodied stark dichotomies of democracy and white supremacy. Chapter 7 examines the 1930s as a critical turning point in the history of self-service, when the application of self-service retailing to huge supermarket store spaces generated a new round of experimentation during the economic crisis of the Great Depression. This chapter connects the origins of supermarkets to the long-term experimentation of independent store owners and small local or regional chains that continue to invent influential and enduring self-service methods throughout the 1930s that shaped the ways that supermarkets worked. Store operators reimagined the mechanisms for systematizing the shopping pathway, mobilizing merchandise, and silent salesmanship, integrating service departments, especially the butcher counter, along the self-service pathway, and connecting them to a centralized checkout process helped to ensure that large store spaces worked effectively as orderly machines for automatic selling. It is tempting to look for the origins of supermarkets in large stores, but when they built their self-service grocery departments, supermarket entrepreneurs followed the lead of small store owners who had been experimenting with self-service systems for decades. The book's conclusion marks the end of the developmental stage of self-service store invention. Embraced as an industry standard by the new Supermarket Institute at their fourth annual meeting in 1940, self-service achieved technological momentum. Self-service stores stopped being physically compartmentalized as specialized retail spaces, and the grocery industry began the widespread conversion to self-service retailing led by supermarket expansion after World War II. The store design process shifted from local vernacular experimentation to corporate financing and policy making. Not until 1946 did Carl Dippmann, editor of Progressive Grocer, declare, "Self-service food store operation is no longer on trial." The dominance of supermarkets built by large corporations in the second half of the 20th century has obscured the role of small firms in the invention of the American self-service store. The broad conversion of consumer landscapes to self-service in the 20th century was driven by multiple factors. We know more about the external factors that made it possible: the rise of prepackaged brand name products, the spread of the automobile and new technologies like the cash register and refrigeration, ideas of scientific management and business efficiency, then the social interactions that shaped how self-service worked inside stores. The chain store owners and independent grocers who invented the self-service store in the early 20th century produced lasting cultural, technological, and business changes that transformed the practice and meaning of shopping. Beyond Piggly Wiggly documents the essential role that small-town American grocers and their customers played in that process before 1940, when self-service was still on trial. 1. Machines for automatic selling. The foremost inventor of his time, Thomas Edison, was among the earliest to take on the challenge of self-service store design. In 1910, the New York Times featured Edison's work on an automatic clerkless shop. "This is the machine age," Edison declared as he described the organized efficiency of a candy factory where one worker operated multiple machines to produce standardized chocolate drops faster than he could count. That the most prominent American inventor at the turn of the century considered store design a test worthy of his attention demonstrates both the importance attached to improving how stores worked and a widely shared faith in technological solutions for problems of distribution. Small-town merchants incorporated new inventions into their strategies for selling. Telephones expanded the reach of the store. Cash registers and adding machines systematized bookkeeping in what one historian has described as the first step toward automating retail and customer transactions. But Edison and others bemoaned the fact that all of these new technologies had done little to change the ways that stores were physically designed to sell. Clerk wages represented one of the biggest fixed costs for grocery stores. Workers who served crowds of demanding customers during early morning and evening rush hours often stood idle as customer traffic dwindled over the course of a workday. Could stores be designed to work without so many clerks? Edison claimed dramatically that in an automatic store, one man could do the work which is now done by 50 grocers. Stores were a focus of attention at the turn of the century because of the high cost of living. Despite dramatic changes in the industrialization of food production between 1880 and 1930, working-class people spent as much as half their income feeding their families. Stores were an artifact of a distribution system that some observers believed had failed to keep up with the innovations of mass production. The world's work echoed the general consensus. The cost of producing what we eat, wear, and use is often not as great as the cost of selling these things to us. Are there too many retail stores? Economist Paul Nystrom asked in his study of retailing. Nystrom complained, "Production has been the object of solicitous scientific study in laboratory and school, while distribution has been left largely to itself." Government researchers, business experts, and a variety of other industry stakeholders, from advertisers to home economists, promoted new strategies for improving the ways stores worked. The idea that retailing could be organized using scientific principles increasingly shaped store operation. Practices that became known as scientific retailing included setting fixed prices for products, organizing store spaces into departments to improve worker efficiency, and emphasizing volume sales and high turnover of merchandise as measures of business success beyond the gross profit margin. New concerns about sanitation and germs created unprecedented demands for cleanliness inside stores. These features came to define what it meant to be a modernizing retailer. Scientific managers studied workers' movements to improve store arrangement for increased efficiency. But only a small specialized segment of the grocery trade embraced self-service as a volume strategy during the 1920s. Self-service stores took scientific retailing to new extremes by creating store interiors that functioned as coordinated systems for automatic selling. Ironically, the small store owners who were so often portrayed as the cause of inefficiency in the distribution system became the most important architects of the modern self-service store. It is useful to apply the stages of invention defined by historians of technology to evaluate the phases of inventing the self-service store before 1940. During the phase of initial invention in the World War I era, self-service stores appeared as oddities, a temporary response to wartime economic hardships. In the 1920s, self-service stores entered an important experimental stage of development, described by historian of technology David Nye as a social process through which inventions are adjusted to suit the needs of specific users and ensure affordable cost of production. Although store designers made reducing overhead costs a high priority, the process of experimentation was capital-intensive and the result in profit uncertain. Industry leaders promoted open display principles as a method for improving clerk efficiency rather than fully systematized self-service store arrangements. Dozens of self-service store designs were patented, underscoring their reputation as a specialized form of retailing during this developmental stage. At the turn of the 20th century, numerous industrialized societies experimented with new forms of self-service retailing as a strategy for lowering the costs of distribution and speeding up the sales process inside the store. Food service retailers led the way, experimenting with automatic restaurants and cafeterias in the early 1900s in Germany, South Africa, the United States, and elsewhere. As historian Angelica Epple has argued, self-service retailing has a polycentric history involving many unknown tinkerers, and it is a history that can be told only as a transnational venture among various industrialized societies. Grocers initially looked to vending machines and cafeteria precedents for design inspiration to rethink how to organize their store spaces as systems for automatic selling. Though important design influences came from international sources, the cafeteria-style self-service store would ultimately prevail in American store design. As self-service stores became linked to national narratives of modernity and democracy in a context of wartime patriotism, cafeteria-style self-service stores became popularly understood as uniquely American inventions of the machine age. Edison and the automat. In 1910, there was no fixed idea about what a self-service store should look like. When Edison planned his clerkless store, he did not include open shelving or market baskets as part of his store design. Instead, he filled the selling floor with dozens of vending machines. At the time, retailers included self-service display features in their stores. Marshall J. Bailey composed treatises on store fixtures for System, the magazine of business, and wrote, "The ideal is a fixture from which the customer can select goods without assistance, pay the cashier, and leave the store." A few other early writers shared this goal. In recommending price marks in 1909, American Grocer maintained that customers like to be at liberty to inspect the goods, find the price, and make a decision as to purchase without being interfered with by a clerk. What distinguishes Edison's store from these examples is that he went beyond a focus on improving a single store fixture. He did not try to invent a better...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.